Thanks to all of you, Bells. And I do have to point out, if you're observant, look at the title of the prelude and then the name of the arranger. Even now they're not laughing. Oh, well, I guess us musicians like that joke. Good morning and welcome to Christ United Methodist Church to this final Sunday of Advent. I'm so glad that you're here, and I want you to be glad you're here. I'm going to invite you to stand and greet one another in the name of our Lord. But I'm very pleased to introduce the Lee family, who will be lighting our Advent candles today.
God's chosen people often turned away from the law and were less than faithful. Yet they were still God's chosen people. Long before Christ was born, God made a promise to King David that his throne would be established forever through God's faithful love.
On the night Christ came to earth, that promise was fulfilled. Out of the house of David, the Savior arose, a Savior given to redeem the whole world.
God's love for us truly does endure forever. And in remembrance of God's mighty acts through Jesus Christ, we light the candle of love. Let us pray. Lord God, help us always to remember that we are redeemed through our faith in your Son. No matter how far we stray, you're always right there waiting for us, loving us. We rejoice in your steadfast love for all the people of the world, fulfilled in the birth of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Between of God, love child, Christ child, heaven's lightning rod. This year, at the day I ride, when Christmas comes for everyone, everyone alive. Up thy peace, child, God's stupendous song. Star and stars that shine. This year, let the day arrive when Christmas comes for everyone, everyone alive.
Would you please stand as you are able and join me in the call to worship? God shows up in the most unexpected places.
In the smallest, most insignificant town in the foreign occupied territory.
God shows up in the most unexpected ways.
Through mysterious messengers who say, "You are blessed."
God shows up in the most unexpected times.
In moments of silence or laughter or fear or exhaustion or peace.
However unexpected, the message of Advent and Christmas is this.
God shows up. And the mountains in reply echo in their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Shepherds were keeping a watch on their sheep when at once in the sky to their questioning eyes angels appearing, bearing glad tidings, sang with a splendor of joy and surprise. Gloria in excelsis Deo, Gloria in the angels sing. Glory to God and peace on earth, the song of angels announces. announcing the birth. Don't be afraid, said an angel to shepherds who stood in amazement and shook with fright. For unto you is born in a manger, a baby, a Savior, a blessed sight. Gloria, rea, in excelsis Deo, Gloria, rea, did the angel sing. Glory to God and peace on earth, the song of angels announcing the birth. Hurry to Bethlehem, run to the stable, and witness the one who was sent from above. Kneel and adore and worship the Christ child, born of a woman, yet born of God's love. Glory. Gloria, rea, did the angel sing. Glory to God and peace on earth, the song of angels announcing the birth. Gloria, gloria, in excelsis Deo. Gloria,
today's Old Testament reading is from Micah 5, 2 through 5. As for you, Bethlehem of Ephrathah, though you are the least significant of Judah's forces, one who is to be a ruler in Israel on my behalf will come out of you. His origin is from remote times, from ancient days. Therefore, he will give them up until the time when she who is in labor gives birth. The rest of his kin will return to the people of Israel. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. They will dwell secure because he will surely become great throughout the earth. He will become our peace.
Bells ring away, hear what they say, sounding the call, sharing with all. Glorious born, Jesus is born, wonderful word, let it be heard. Savior of all, born in a stall, heavenly birth, God here on earth.
Bells ever ring, welcome the King, tell of the one, God's only Son. Wonderful song, all sing along, thanks be to God, sing Gloria. Hear angels sing, glad tidings bring. In peace on the earth and goodwill to all. Sing a welcome song of Alleluia.
Sing a welcome song of Alleluia.
Bells ring away, hear what they say, sounding the call, sharing with all. Glorious morn, Jesus is born, wonderful word, let it be heard.
Bells ever ring,
welcome the King,
tell of the one,
God's only Son.
Wonderful song,
all sing along,
thanks be to God,
sing Gloria,
hear angels singing, glad tidings bringing, peace on the earth and goodwill to all.
Sing a welcome song of Alleluia,
sing a welcome song of Alleluia.
Bells ring away, hear what they say, sound in the call, sharing with all.
Bells ever ring, welcome.
welcome the King, tell of the one, God's only Son.
Savior of all, born in a
of the ring, welcome the King, tell of the one, God's only Son. Wonderful song, all sing along, thanks be to God, sing Gloria. Hear angels singing, glad tidings bringing, peace on the earth and goodwill to all.
Sing a welcome song of Hallelujah,
sing a welcome song of Hallelujah.
Bells ring away, hear what they say, sounding the call, sharing with all. Glorious morn, Jesus is born, wonderful word, let it be heard.
Sing glory.
So today's gospel reading, we will read responsively. So if you would turn to pages... Okay, very good. That's right. Okay. So this is the Magnificat, or the Song of Mary. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord.
My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, who has looked with favor on me, a lowly servant.
From this day, all generations shall call me blessed. The arm of the Lord is strong and has scattered the proud in their conceit.
God has cast down the mighty from their thrones and lifted up the lowly.
God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich empty away.
God has come to the aid of Israel, the chosen of his servant, and every promise of mercy.
Thank you.
Would you pray with me and for me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts always be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So how many of you grew up in a small town? Whereabouts? I know you guys were in Idaho, right? Nebraska? Michigan, the hand, yes. And how many people were in your town? Less than 1,000. Anybody smaller? 200? 100? There you go. I think you're the winner, Maxine. An isolated homestead. Just me. So there were like 5 of you, right? 4. Okay. Well, I have a friend from seminary who, when we were each assigned to our first churches in our respective annual conferences, she was sent to serve a town of around 100 people in Kentucky. And I listened to her complaints over the phone for a while from my own whopping Western Colorado town of 1,100, and then asked her how far she had to drive to get to a grocery store. And she said, "It's terrible. I have to go 7 miles. And what a hardship, isn't it? Then I simply said that it was a little different out west, that some folks might have to drive 1 hour or 2 or 4 to reach civilization. When I started thinking about small towns, I realized we have some great little towns in our western part here. Places like Ophir, Utah, 23 people in Ophir. Lost Springs, Wyoming. I like the name. They have 4. Then there's Warm River, Idaho that has 3. But my personal favorite for a small town name is Last Chance, Colorado. Last chance for what? I've always wondered. But if you have ever lived in a small town, then you'll be familiar with some of the small town jokes. You know you're in a small town when the city limit signs are back-to-back on the same pole. You know you're in a small town when it takes 30 seconds to reach your destination and you drove clear across town. You know you're in a small town when your kid acts up in school and the clerk at the hardware store knows about it before school's even out for the day. Or when you dial a wrong phone number and the person on the other end supplies you with the correct one. That's actually happened to me. Well, you get the idea. Small towns don't get a whole lot of respect. The mayor of Industry, California, jokes that people go to Hollywood because they want to be famous. People go to Silicon Valley because they want to be rich. And people go to Industry, California because they get bad directions. Small, seemingly insignificant places, though, can sometimes surprise us. Olathe, Colorado, the first church that I served, town of 1,100, taught me how to be a pastor. Plains, Georgia, population 755, produced probably one of the greatest humanitarians of our time, Jimmy Carter. Abraham Lincoln was from Knob Creek, Kentucky, a town so small that it no longer exists. You don't have to be a big city to produce a big person. Bethlehem Ephrathah, in biblical times, had a population, they think, around 500 people. The prophet Micah had to call it Bethlehem Ephrathah in order to distinguish it from the other Bethlehem that was in northern Israel and was bigger and better known. Bethlehem Ephrathah is in southern Israel, and it was what was known then as the southern kingdom or the land of Judah. Bethlehem Ephrathah was the kind of place that gives rise to the question, can anything good come out of, like, can anything good come out of Ophir, Utah? Can anything good come out of Last Chance? Can anything good actually come out of a backwater little hamlet called Bethlehem Ephrathah? It's not where folks would expect a king to come from. Jerusalem was the big city. Jerusalem was the place for power. But Bethlehem? Who would think to look for a mighty ruler in that little place? I'm sure that people of Jesus' time had many things that they were seeking in their lives, just like we do. It seems that just being human means we have quests that we are after, things we seek and look for and work for. For some people, life is a quest for power. These folks spend their time planning and scheming to gain power over others, to be in control of other people. Now, in our country, the symbol for that would probably be Washington, D.C. In ancient Israel, it certainly would have been Jerusalem. That's where the power was, not Bethlehem. For some of us, life is a quest for money. We'd like to have all the fine and expensive and sparkly things in life, and I suppose if we had to have a city that represented that in the U.S., it would maybe Las Vegas, where people are drawn to chasing after vast sums of money and losing them rapidly. For some people, the glory of winning is their quest. Our sports culture says that winning isn't everything, it's the only thing. In business, competition to come out on top can be rampant and ruthless to such a degree that people are trampled on. They get crushed in the process. I guess if you were looking at that kind of winning in business, maybe New York City would be the place. People seeking power and money and glory look to places where things are hopping, where people are playing their kind of game. People seeking power and glory and wealth don't tend to look for those things in places like Ophir or Lost Springs or Last Chance or Bethlehem Ephrathah, which makes Bethlehem the perfect place for true power and true glory and true riches to be born. We know that earthly rulers come and go, that worldly power passes, that riches and things will rot and rust, and what are we left with underneath it all? What's our real quest underneath it, the ultimate quest? It's the search for meaning and for hope. Our quest for the divine presence, to be in the midst of the sacred, it's our quest for God. When all else is stripped away. Unexpectedly, in the Bible, lowliness, humility, humbleness is often associated with this ultimate quest for God, for the God who is the only one with lasting power and riches and glory. In our scripture stories, the lowly are exalted, and that's certainly part of the prophet Micah's message and emphasis. He was active as a prophet in Jerusalem 700 years before the birth of Christ. And it was a time when there was incredible income inequality. Sound familiar? And incredible income inequality. And the rich were getting richer because they had set up rules that allowed them to take land away from the poor. And so people who were poor were becoming so poor that they even lost the land that their families had worked on for generations. Micah himself was a lowly farmer turned prophet of God. He stood up for the poor and the homeless and the exploited, and he made enemies. He made enemies from among the wealthy and the powerful. Micah was a small town boy too. He came from a little place called Moresheth, which was even smaller and less powerful than Bethlehem. And I can almost hear the rulers of his day say to him, "Who do you think you are talking to us like that? You're from Moresheth, for God's sake." Micah championed the poor and the oppressed. And he's probably most famous for his question and answer, "What does the Lord require of you? To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God." Justice, kindness, and reverence. These are the keys to our quest to know God and to discover hope and to live a life of depth and meaning. Justice and kindness and reverence, they are the signs of the true people of God. And they're the characteristics of the one who comes from a little town of Bethlehem. They are the characteristics of the Messiah. If the rulers and leaders and wealthy folks that scoffed at Micah's prophecy some 700 years before Jesus, if they had really stopped to think about it, they would have realized that Micah was hinting at a very important connection here. Bethlehem was the birthplace of King David. And pretty universally among the ancient Israelites, David was the king that was the best king ever. And he was another small town boy. And so the Christmas story, like so many biblical teachings, turns the world's power structure on its head. A baby is about to be born in the most humble circumstances, and yet he is the one who will change the world forever. A mother is about to give birth surrounded by animals in a stable, and yet she is the one who realizes the impact and the importance of this birth. Mary understands what God is doing here, and it comes through loud and clear in the Magnificat, that scripture that we read together about God humbling the powerful and lifting up the lowly, about God scattering the proud and exposing their deceit, about God throwing down kings from their thrones because a different kind of power is about to enter the world. God is doing something entirely new, and it all begins in a town that maybe wasn't even on the map at that time. Bethlehem Ephrathah. What is insignificant in our world is about to become the center of the universe. What is insignificant to us is never insignificant to God. There is no person who is unimportant to God. There is no place that is unimportant to God. And God is about to do a new thing. Just wait and see what God is up to. Amen. I'm sure that the affirmation of faith is one that's written exactly for this Christmas season. And I invite you to join me in reading it. We believe in God, the creator of all things, the giver of life, and the bringer of light. We believe in our Messiah, our Savior, guide, and friend. We believe that in this holy time of year, God's promises ring true, and our hearts will be renewed. We believe that in all things, in all trials, and in all joys, God is near to support and sustain us. We believe that in the gift of the Christ child, all sin is forgiven and all hope is restored. Amen.
Prayer. Everlasting God, you blessed Mary by making her the mother of your Son, Jesus Christ. You blessed Bethlehem as the birthplace of the Savior. You have blessed us as well. with the gifts of salvation and life itself. Out of these blessings, we give you back these offerings this day, knowing that your promises will be fulfilled. We pledge our lives to you in the name of the one who brings us peace. Amen. There is no one who is unimportant to God.
There is no place that is unimportant to God.
May we celebrate these coming days knowing that good news is always near.
May we celebrate.